Welcome to the Brand Doctor Podcast, strategies that help entrepreneurs build reputable and profitable brands. Here's your host, Henry Kaminski Jr.
So what's going on, guys? I'm going to take you behind the scenes today. I have, and you guys heard me say this over and over again, I have many different coaches in my life. I have a therapist, I have a mindset coach, I have a media coach, I have a business development coach. And today I'm actually going to introduce you to my media coach, who is Jess Topfeld. So Jess, what's going on, man?
A pleasure to be here. And you know, you and I were going to do this session anyway. I happen to be sitting here in my studio where I have the little backdrop that it's really just the wall that I use when I do interviews. And I just did an interview. And then you and I, we've actually been both doing work. You're my branding coach / you're going to help me with other stuff. So if people poke around for other videos, they're going to see me not dressed up the way I would, where I normally am on brand. And, but today we're focusing on you because, I commend you for sharing this with everybody because you don't know what I'm going to say.
I don't.
You did this thing that's off brand, but you know what? It's on brand because, being transparent is one of the things that Henry does. He films these videos every single day and he tells you what he's thinking and he shows his personality and he doesn't have to do that. But he does. And then you end up connecting with people who say, this is how we got connected. I just said, I like this guy. I like the way he thinks. I like the stuff that he says. And, you know, I'm on board.
Boom. Let's
do something. Right.
Boom.
Boom. And then here we are.
Yeah. And so I've reached out to, so Jess and I have been working now for like a year almost. We got introduced by one of our mutual friends, Daniel. Why can't his last name bring to me? I can't think of his last name.
We'll keep it a secret.
He was the mystery mentor back in the last year anyway.
Yes.
That I used to speak about on my Facebook lives. So we were introduced. So today we're going to be talking about some tactical stuff. I mean, what Jess has done for me from a media standpoint and a presentation standpoint has really helped me sort of cement, if you will, my presence online, really polish it up a bit, if you will. Before meeting Jess, I was sort of all over the place. And Jess has really helped me sort of understand some of the things that I was completely unaware of before meeting him. Like, for example, composition fatigue, video composition fatigue, meaning doing videos from the same location day in and day out. Subconsciously, your audience actually gets tired of you because it looks the same and they don't feel like there's any sort of, what do they call that? Pattern interrupt, if you will, if we're talking NLP, but everything seems to be mundane and the same. And until you break up the backgrounds, right, you may be overlooked, right? So having that fresh perspective from a composition standpoint when you're doing video, super, super helpful when it comes to connecting with your audience. So I didn't know that. So today, we're going to continue that conversation and Jess is going to help me sort of with some new sort of tactics and stuff like that to help me connect with my audience better, because that's what it comes down to.
Yeah. And one thing that I want to get you doing and doing more of is showing up in the press. Actually, behind me is the New York Times article where I appeared in there. And up over there is Inc., Entrepreneur, and Fortune that I appeared in. And I show people how to do it. I gave you my special template. And there's no reason why they wouldn't want to hear what you say about different people's brands. I think you were a little less interested in talking about politics, which is fine. Me too. I actually haven't done one interview since Trump took, one interview about politics since Trump took office. I just don't want to get involved in that whole thing. I don't need to. I have other articles and other pieces where I get to talk about what I'm talking about. I have talked about politicians before. When Anthony Weiner, you may remember him, we're so proud of him as our New York politician who was putting pictures of himself in his underwear on Twitter to girls. By the way, I don't recommend that. I'm going to go out on a limb and say I don't recommend that. But I sent something out. You know, hey, a media consultant saying, how does he can he bounce back from this? Which I was saying at the time, no, not really. And he really has to, you know, reshape his life, which he didn't do. And now he's in jail now. And I could go out and I could do more interviews on that if I wanted, but that's not, I'm done talking about
it. Yeah, there's no interest in it. Yeah, I mean, there's no interest in it. So, yeah.
But wait, I'll tell you, at the time, when the story first broke, I was featured in almost 50 newspapers.
Wow.
Yes. And it was because of one quote, which is using the soundbite system. It's funny. I was just interviewed. I'm gonna click share screen. I'm going to show you. I happen to have it on my computer here. And let's see, you should be able to see this. So I sent out this email, and right here is the quote. And it's using this thing that I call the soundbite system. And you and I are going to craft these together because we're working together on this. Mm-hmm. But the quote that they use that they love, I sent out an email with a whole bunch of quotes. Can he repair his image? He can never truly get past this story, so I'm owning my words. He has mortally wounded his political career. Ooh, it's getting, you know, a little
juicy
in there. But it doesn't mean he can't star in a reality show, a little pop culture stuff, or host a program on CNN, which is a jab at any of those outlets that, you know, hire someone when they have a sex scandal, which at the time CNN had a Elliot Spitzer on. Mm-hmm. And they loved it. It went to all these newspapers. So the thing is, I might even take a little bit of time today and go through the news and come up with a few extra stories. So my thought, I want you to talk about, usually when we do these things, I have a few things I bring to the table that I want to share with Henry, and then he has a few things. Uh-huh. So basically, I want to talk about publicity. Uh-huh. I started telling you I want to, we're going to do some one-on-one at some point, but I want you to join. I have an upcoming group program for doing a better job in front of the press and practicing the techniques for the sound bites and coming up with the best answers and having the most control and all that stuff. And so I said, hey, join that class, and then we'll do even more. So you get twice as much when we do some face-to-face. And then we'll chat again about the live stuff that you do. And then one thing I think Henry does an amazing job of is consistently being out there in front of people. And then even he acknowledges, I mean, he's a guy, you just mentioned all these coaches that he has, and you know, those phrases or those quotes out there where they say, you know, everybody needs a coach, and even the best people in the world only become the best people in the world with a coach. And I think the two of us know it, and boy, do you make sure to practice it. But you know, you've looked at some of your lives and you said some of them are great. And some people call me and say, you're my guy, I want to work with you. And then there are sometimes where you're like, I don't know, I felt off today. Uh-huh. And, you know, maybe it was, or did I talk too long mm-hmm. about that one thing? Mm-hmm. And these are the questions that we have to ask ourselves when we do these things. So publicity workshop and lies. And what did you want to talk about today, Henry?
So I was thinking about some more tactical ways of presenting my thoughts. And so I'm having some issues with the multiple view camera setup that I have here, and I haven't used it. So I'm in a while. I'm trying to get that sorted out because every time I do a live with that functionality, everybody goes crazy and people are asking me, how am I doing it? What am I doing it? What's my setup? And so I got to get that. I got to get that sort of ironed out before I go and do it again. But I mean, some of the tactical things like relevancy. I think that's very important. Like, how could I take a pulse of my audience to create content that has more relevancy to them? One of the things that I realized is this. When I speak about mindset on my Facebook Lives, right? That seems to get a tremendous amount of engagement, all right? And tying that back to brand development, this might be a story I'm just telling myself. It's not necessarily true, but I'm having difficulty taking mindset and wrapping it back into brand development and making it relevant, because I don't want to be known as a mindset coach, but mindset has a lot to do with brand development. If you don't have the right mindset, if you can't articulate what it is your purpose is, then so I'm actually doing a really good job here doing this with you right now. But so again, it's just that practice. But the question is, how do I survey, if you will, the audience and get those relevant topics back to me so that I can create lives, you know, with them?
Yeah, I actually have a social media coach who has just been pushing community. In fact, he even reformatted how he talks about himself or rebranded himself as a someone who teaches and coaches folks how to become community builders. Mm-hmm. Because he said, everyone gets too lost saying, you know, social media. He's like, it's about community. You happen to be using social media. So the thing is, I would talk to people in your Facebook group, and you're in a whole bunch of Facebook groups that you share and elsewhere on the internet that you're sharing all of this content that you're putting together. But I'd go in there and I'd ask people questions and ask them for more questions that you can create content out of. Something I started doing in one of the groups that I lead, and I think you saw some of the videos, is I took questions that they had. I actually made it one step easier for myself, which is I had a live event and I said, I want all of you to write down on the notepads that the hotel gave you three things. First, I said, I want you to write right on top of each other, FCC, frustrations, concerns, and challenges. I said, tell me your frustrations and your concerns and challenges. And you know, in the world of sales, we want to know what are their pains? What are they dealing with? So just that created about 60 different items that I can do videos around.
Oh my God.
And it's my community.
That's 60 days of content, if you will. I mean, you could take one question and make a live out of each one.
I'm going to just grab it where it's somewhere here in the room. Oh man, we went and cleaned up. Here we go. And the ones that they did on those little notepads, I did differently. But these ones, I actually just got back from the state of Washington, and they fill out these little end evaluations. But I do something similar in there, where I'm trying to figure out how can I get people to give me questions, give me issues. So sometimes when you say questions, they say, "Oh, I don't have a question." But if we reframe it to frustrations or concerns or challenges, you know, put your biggest challenges. I mean, you're already starting to see, if you say they're talking about mindset, that there are some pieces rising to the top that people really need to hear more about. Mm-hmm. So you can go back in and you see what some of these are. You know, you can ask them, you can ask some of your clients even while you're talking to them, you know, what's your biggest frustration, or have you noticed this, and keep a little note, and you know, include that as what the community is talking about when they're not always chiming in. But I know I have to directly start asking them and getting them and say, what are some of these big things? I think we have to ask them a question to bring it out of them.
Right.
Something I said to you once was, you know, one of the best things that we can do, certainly in these videos, is to explore the problem deeply. Instead of trying to solve everything, because people will really connect and say, that's my problem. And, you know, what do you do about that? And they'll want more. And if you give them every last solution, which I know you don't, because, I mean, sometimes you feature some of these videos of you helping a client, but ultimately they need to be helped.
Right.
They, you know, that's not going to give them all the answers of who the heck they are and what their brand is all about. Every time we talk, you know, I get an aha just from the questions you ask me. By the way, I think you could turn some of those questions that you use just as part of your process to figure out people's brand. I think you could use those for fodder and for speaking to the community.
I didn't even think of that.
Yeah, put them out there so they don't know, you know, hey, that's part of, you know, what I ask clients. But right. You're just asking one of the, you know,
numerous questions that goes into the discovery and the diagnosis phase of what I do. I love that. Exploring the problem deeper versus solving the problem. That's a great piece of advice. The frustrations, concerns, challenges. That's phenomenal too. So here's a question. And I know you don't wake up every day and say to yourself, I have to watch Henry's lives today. I have to continuously watch what Henry's doing every single moment of his career. But my question is, and this is what a lot of people have said they love about me, is I'm not afraid to ask those brutal questions that a lot of people are afraid to ask about themselves. And so looking back at, I don't know, the last couple lives that you interacted with or saw of mine, what, when you were watching them, because you're pretty good at this, you'll send me a Voxer message or something along those lines, like, hey, do this next time, or hey, do that next time, or this was good, right? This was really good. Do this more. Where are some of the areas of improvement that you see that I can just shed some light on so I can correct that?
I'm going to click share screen here and I'll show you. So over here, yes, I get fatigued when I see this background, which we're using today, but you and I were just chatting anyway. And you have this amazing setup, which is just in total reverse of this shot, looking backwards at your desk. In fact, I have my computer on a lectern, which I think I've showed you before. See that? Over there? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just a lectern. Look, you get to see one of my other backgrounds. and basically, then I can move this anywhere in the room very easily. I'm taking for granted that if your computer is a laptop. And is that computer a laptop? I think it is.
The one behind me, yes, but it's plugged into all the cameras. So okay. It's not something I could move around. But I really need to get to the bottom of that setup, because then I'll be able to, you know, use that setup more.
Right. These things I think are really cool, and I think it shows off your brand because it gets me thinking about brand.
Okay.
You know, here's something moving, and I wouldn't expect that. Emotional design, and I'm thinking, oh, it makes me ask a question, which is, what's that about? I know we're talking about your lives, but something I noticed here is, you know, look, this is moving. Is this how people see your business? Is blurry and it's through a you know, rainy glass. I don't usually see graphics like this. So, you know, I think that's kind of interesting. I'm just giving you a sense of what it looks like from the outside. As far as the videos, and let's see if I click at the top here under photos and just make videos show up. This is something I was thinking of too. Such work and detail go into these, and you've got these, you know, these really nice suits that you have on here, and you're out and you're all around. You know, I wonder if people see, sometimes you and I dress down a little bit, if they see that and how that plays. Now, I think you're on enough where they get the Henry personality, and you can go past it. And I had said to you before we hit record, I said, hey, you're seeing me the way I look on camera, because Henry has seen me when I don't think I'm on camera. I have a baseball cap. I'm unshaved. I have like some t-shirt with something stupid written on it. Or
well, typically when I'm coaching you, so it's, you know, you're dressed down. You're in your coaching attire. Like, you know,
exactly.
When teams are in practice, they're not dressed in their uniforms per se. They're in their practice uniforms. And that's what you're in.
Right. But that's not, I know I don't appear in person in front of clients that way.
Right.
And sometimes, you know, hundreds or thousands of people may see something I do on social media. By the way, videos. Here we go. Let's see. I'll type in videos. And you know what? Maybe you don't have every live on here. Oh, you do have a lot.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just bringing this up as a decision. Does it mean now you have to get dressed up every day, even though, you know, the modern day way of working is we don't have to rush into, both of us live on two sides of New York City, mm-hmm. right? And then, which one day we're going to meet up in the middle mm-hmm. over there. Actually, next month we'll see each other.
Yep.
But we don't have to go in. There was a time I used to rush in every day. And I think people out there know they want the result. They want to see what are the results that you've done. My point is that it doesn't matter if you're in a home office and you have a very nice home. By the way, this, shocker, this is actually my home office. And even though you can see out the fake genuine backdrop of New York City at the window that's over there, when I do go into New York City and I have some space there, it looks out and you look diagonally at basically a brick wall. Which is not exciting. Actually, if you look way, way up on an angle, you can see a piece of the Empire State Building. but that doesn't look good on camera. So anyway, the point is, I'm just saying, looking at every last thing for brand. So yeah. What do I think when I see some of these? I'm going to give you my initial, but some of it is me, and some of it is I know, you know, what we're going to talk about, how other people engage. So this one, I'm just fatigued with this backdrop. If you're getting feedback that people love the multiple cameras, then you got to spend a little time playing with that again, figuring out how do you get that to, because that's an extra challenge for Henry, to talk to everybody and click and, you know, make sure that it's on camera. But I definitely like shooting in that other direction. So if you can just get the setup, maybe you put all the wires on the other side.
No, and here's the problem: the software continues to crash on me.
Oh,
so it's that. So you know, I'm working with support to try to get that. So we downloaded a new version this morning. It popped up beautifully. I did a little test run. I recorded it. Everything was great.
You know,
and I came back and it crashed. And I was like, "Are you kidding me?" So.
The thing that's disappointing is I know that Henry paid a guy, it wasn't cheap, who came in, who set all that stuff up. And you know, you should talk to him. There are a couple other options that are out there. I mean, it's upsetting because it should just work.
Yeah.
You said, I'm not messing around. I'm going to pay somebody. I'm not going to cheap out. I'll get whatever you tell me I need to get. Let's do it. So if the software is crapping out, is it the computer? Is it the software? If it's the software, well then, you know,
yeah,
something has to change.
We'll get to the bottom. I'm confident that we're going to get to the bottom of it. We'll get to the bottom of it.
I can just quickly mention, just for you to have in your head, there are two other options. One is this thing called the Mevo, which is this one camera. You know about it?
I've heard of it.
Okay, so it's this one camera, and it looks like the Alexa tall Alexa thing. Mm-hmm. And it looks weird. It looks like a speaker and you put it, it's longer because it has a big battery under it. And then if you buy the version, it comes with a big tripod. You can put that somewhere. And then on an iPad, you basically get the wide shot, but then you draw a square that you want the tight shot. And then you can cut between the wide shot and the tight shot. And if it's in the corner, you can actually do like a slightly, it'll do like different angles, even though it's in one spot.
Hmm.
And that's kind of interesting. And you can move that into different spots and then do that thing where you set up right before you go live the big square and then the little square, and there's a way to integrate that with live. I had considered doing it and probably doing it in this space, and I had actually just forgotten about it, and maybe I'll go back and do that, because I was thinking about putting in that corner so you could see all these different looks. Mm-hmm. That I can, and down over there I have the desk that I sit at, but I'd have it as kind of a V like this behind me. And there's one other thing where there are a couple of different programs that use iOS devices where instead of a whole huge setup, you have a couple of these, and then you can cut basically, you know, with another iOS device between, you know, between them. All of this really is bells and whistles compared to, you know, what it is that you're saying. But if you're recording every day, we kind of have to show up in a slightly different way. And I guess the message I get is, hey, the branding guy even knows about a couple other technical things that I don't see anybody else doing.
Right. Right. So getting back to the suited up Henry versus the dressed down version Henry, right?
Right. This is the dressed down. This is the day I was thinking about it. I was right. I said, I'm going to ask you, mm-hmm. I mean, listen, I know in some ways I'm going to contradict myself, because I know I said, listen, I like some level of people sharing a little bit about their personal life. Mm-hmm. And I like one of the lives that you did where you had your son sitting next to you. I think your wife was less interested of like, you know, it's my wife too, of like putting the baby on camera and stuff. Mm-hmm. And you had your dog next to you. The dog's probably still fair game.
Yeah, but Canelo loves the camera too.
And I thought that was funny. You were telling something. I think the dog licked your face. And you're like, I know, you like it too. And you went back into the thing. It gives you something else to play off of. You know, even sometimes sharing some of those stories. Something else that keeps being thrown back in my face. And then I have to go back and think about how you're using them is other stories. So on the speaker training side of what I do, it's all about the formula is stories and messages. You have a point or a message and you tell some story. And that's basically, if you ever listen to a great public speaker, it's basically what they're doing. And then the my social media guy, who whose name is Warren Carlyle, the fourth, that's how he puts it on social media so people can find him. He talks all about community, and he said, you know, everything that you just said about stories for speaking is absolutely transferable online, because people get drawn into those stories, you know, as opposed to data dumping. You know, you got to do this, you got to do this, and we're kind of teaching and we're in that mode. So whether it's a story about those frustrations and concerns or challenges in answering questions for people, it's a sweet spot to tell stories, you know, even though there's two sides of me who's answering like the cool backgrounds and changing things up, and Henry's walking all over town or he's walking the dog. Then we get to see a little bit more. Oh, this is probably one where we actually see the dog. So, let's see here. I think you get up and you walk
like $1.50.
$1.50.
Oh, the meme. Oh, this was me testing out the smooth.
Oh, okay, right. Yeah. Oh, so you got the selfie stick with that is a little bit smoother.
Yeah. And I'm still trying to play with that puppy, because it's again, like you said, when you're doing a live, when you're on video, you should be focused on telling that message or telling that story, right? So yes. when I'm trying to, when I have the smooth in my hand, one thing that I realized was I was trying to make sure that the angle was, you know, was right. And it was literally throwing me off my thought. So I went to the traditional, I went with the traditional selfie stick, which is a little bit more of a, what do they call it? Rigid, you know, right. Like you'll see all of sort of the bumps, if you will, but
yeah.
It was much easier for me to stay focused on my message. And so, and it's funny, let me talk about that for a split second. One of the things that you told me to do was just go out and buy a damn selfie stick, because like as silly as they are, right? As I remember 4 years ago when they came out, right? I mean, if you saw somebody with one of those things, I mean, you pointed and snickered and laughed and made fun and pointed and snickered and
right.
Like, now it's like, you know, you see people in the supermarket using the damn
right.
Right. And you're and people walk by you like you don't even exist, right? So one of the things that I've met, one of the things I thought was brilliant, it was just like, hey, dude, just pull that puppy out and walk around with that and to get that different angle. And so I do it. And it's funny because my driveway is so damn long. It's the perfect length to do a video. I walk up to the street, grab my mail, walk down, and that's my message. That's 5-6 minutes
right.
of content.
And what I want to know is because eventually people will be fatigued on that one too. Right. Like, oh, I saw that already. I want to know what the audience is thinking about that. I think what's coming out of today is to ask them questions separately yes. from the lives, just as many questions about themselves, their biggest frustrations, what do you think is your unique selling proposition when it comes to your brand? What's unique about you? And then they're at least talking about it. But back to the backgrounds and mixing it up. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's basically showmanship. I mean, I guess it's a little bit of your brand too. We want to make it your brand have a certain feel. I don't love this backdrop that you're on right now as much as this backdrop, or really over here mm-hmm. where you actually installed a flat screen. Can you mm-hmm. see this all right?
Yeah.
So you installed a flat screen over here that you can put totally different backdrops in. So you actually printed some cool posters that are similar to the things you put on Instagram, mm-hmm. Which may be the same ones. And so that looks cool, but this can change and you can put the topic name in here mm-hmm. and we can see, I like the way you think with graphics. I don't think I've said that out loud, but your choice of colors and positioning and fonts and the things that you know, the way you kind of put it together, or even the fact that the rain was moving, or even just to have that thought, mm-hmm. I want to see some version of that behind you. So you're telling me something, but I'm saying, well, that looks cool. Mm-hmm.
And that wouldn't be a distraction. That wouldn't be a distraction.
Well, I guess if it's moving, it's a distraction, but if it basically says, frustrations, or it says unique selling proposition, but it has kind of a cool look on it. Mm. I'm still getting the idea of it, that you didn't take a PowerPoint and put black text on a white backdrop with bullet points.
Got it.
Right.
Got it.
I'm like,
it's funny you mention that because my mentor does that. When he does videos, right, he has a slide deck and he's like the king of Helvetica font. And yeah. he has his points in a Helvetica font. On a either bright yellow background, a black background, or a white background. And it's
yes.
it's interesting why I know he does that for a reason.
And it's some consistent branding. Mm-hmm. While we're talking, I was thinking of this guy. I see him pop up with Facebook ads, and it's how to grow your business.
You want to laugh? I've been on that plane.
Hey, I think you have...
Yeah, that's a JetSmarter plane, and I the only reason why I know is because of the pinstripe on the side.
Nice. I've seen shots of you on that plane.
Yeah, yeah. My wife and I were, where'd we go? We went down to Atlanta, and we were on that plane. How funny.
Well, I bring this up because I say, okay, so this is a guy who shows up through, for me, through Facebook ads. I guess I eventually liked it so that it would show up and mm-hmm. And I liked some of the content. I haven't bought from him mm-hmm. yet, I guess. Who knows? I might buy something. But I just as a comparison. So I don't know where his workspace is every day. Mm-hmm. But when he does his videos, mm-hmm. This is the space that he puts out there. He dresses like this all the time. I don't know how to turn the
okay. I've seen this guy. Now, yeah. Because as soon as I see this backdrop, now I recall him. So,
right.
Yes.
And let's see. I'm going to turn Well, I don't want to turn the captions off for everything ever. Well, I'll turn it off for right now. And so he's dressed the way I've seen you in photos. And it's not to say, look, he doesn't do stuff consistently like you do every day. It's kind of a whole thing to get dressed up every day. I have next to me, I'm not going to put it on today, but I have TV makeup next to me, which only takes me a minute to just kind of match my skin tone, but it looks better. In fact, when I did a live thing with an interview earlier, I put on a nice shirt, I put on a sport coat, a little pocket square, but I'm wearing jeans. People don't usually see. If it were summertime, I may not have shoes on. I don't know if he does, but this obviously this is a recorded thing that they put some production value. Now, is this his office every day? I don't know.
That's right.
You know, I don't know for sure if this is his office every day. You know, and you just have to, you know, I can tell it's a custom suit by little markings that he has here, and so I'm getting a sense that he's got a high value luxury brand. And so if he says that you can grow your business into $1 million or multi-million-dollar business, I'm feeling like I believe him, as he has some sort of motorcycle artwork back over here. And you know, he's not putting stuff on. I mean, I know I'm not exactly answering the question. By the way, do you have a hard out in a few minutes, or can we go longer?
I have a hard out. Yeah.
Okay.
So we got about 4 minutes, but I love what you're doing here.
All right. So we'll have to talk more about that, and we'll schedule extra time.
Yeah.
So the main thing is, I'd like to see you shooting in the direction of the screen and put some stuff in the screen.
Okay.
Even if you come up with, say, like three basic templates, you can change a couple words and then like go live.
Yep. That's easy.
Easy. And even though everyone likes the changing cameras, I know that's a source of distraction for you.
It's not. The camera transitioning is easy. It's a click of a mouse button, and I have it. I have my three camera. I have my three camera like thumbnails on the bottom, and I have them set up in a perfect way where I know, okay, this is camera 1, 2, 3.
And 4. Okay.
Yeah, that's easy. That's really, really
it's
easy.
The thing crashing, and you're paying attention to. Is the technology doing what it's supposed to do?
Right. So once I get over that hump, I'm like this close to just finding another software, because now this is becoming more and more prevalent. So just finding
another software. With our remaining time, I wanted to ask you about publicity, which was my lead off thing I was going to ask you about. Was did you send out that press email?
I did not.
Okay. So what was the story again?
The one that you told me to do initially, I did.
Okay. What was that story?
It was seven somethings about building a better brand. I mean, I could seven must knows or something like that when it comes to building a better brand.
So here's my thought. What if we come up with like three more, and then that's going to be a 6-week strategy of you're going to send on our next call, we'll come up with three more, and we're going to write the press email out.
Okay.
We'll come up with three good. We'll come up with a bunch more headlines, but we'll write out the emails. So the emails are done then.
That's going to help tremendously. That's going to help me tremendously, because for whatever reason, I'm blocking myself from doing that. And it's so ridiculous. It just needs to be done. And I think because we meet weekly, I mean, that should take 15 minutes, if that. To craft that. Because you gave me the damn template. It's sitting in my inbox right here. I'm looking at it.
Right. So we're going to come up with three really killer headlines or hooks, as we like to call them. You hook the media. And then what you'd say, we're going to put it into the template. Those will be done. And on the alternate weeks in between, you're going to send an email out saying to them, not sure if you saw this last week. Does this work for you?
Did you catch
it? And we should be able to get you in there. There's so many stories and so many brands that are doing things that are good or bad. How about Elon Musk and SpaceX and putting one of the Tesla Roadsters in space?
I know.
Is that a good branding decision for his other company? Right?
Exactly. Yeah.
They're floating a car in space with little webcams on it.
Yeah.
What a great idea. Nobody, no other car company has a car in space.
On the planet, literally.
Right. And he says, it should be there for at least a few more 100,000 years. Maybe it's warranted for 100,000 years instead of miles.
This is great stuff. So,
all right, so we'll work on that on the next one.
This is extremely helpful. Well, I appreciate you bringing out Sam Ovens, because when I have somebody like that to sort of, you know, gauge, you know, you don't know what you're doing until you gauge it on something else, right?
Right.
And it's like, okay, I see where I could step up. I see where I could be a little bit more polished. I see where I could be a little bit more like that. And it's funny that you bring him up, because he has come past me a couple of times and I haven't jumped on it. And I haven't dug in and studied deeper, you know, what exactly he does. And
he's either British or Australian, and he has that thing. And you've got the New York, New Jersey, you know, guy vibe going on. You know, like, I'm going to tell you how it is. Let's do this.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
Right.
So, that's my unique identity. That's something that you can't take away from me, or you can't say that I'm copying. That's just who I am. And
right.
That's what makes it fun.
So we want to keep, obviously, we want to keep that in and figure out how we mix. Like, you know, we decide, you know, are you wear sport coats more when you're sitting in this space? Does it make the space feel differently? Mm-hmm. You know, I usually keep some hang behind that backdrop. I don't want to make you late for your next.
Yeah, thing. I got to run. I got to run, because I'm looking at my time and I'm like, oh, crap.
Do that.
But listen, Jess, thank you so much once again for all your help. We'll link back up later on today. We'll get scheduled up for next week and we're going to go.
All right.
All right, guys. All
right, we'll talk.
Take care. Bye-bye.
All right. Good luck.
You've been listening to the Brand Doctor Podcast with Henry Kaminski Jr. To get your appointment with the doctor, visit Brand Audit at www.uniquedesigns.net.